So welcome everybody to today's BA Insights session, in which I'm pleased that I've got three excellent guests to talk about business analysis and more specifically ethics within business analysis. So thank you for joining. Thank you everybody for joining as well. If I can ask first of all, just to give yourselves a brief introduction, and if I may, if I could start with Helen, if you would please.
Hi, yeah, and thank you for having me on the session. I'm Helen Holder, and I'm currently working as a senior business analyst within the Ministry of Justice in their Justice Digital arm as part of Digital Prisons.
Yeah. And Imtiaz.
Hiya. Thank you, John, for the invite, and looking forward to today's session. I'm a freelance BA, so I combine project work with clients, as well as training the various BCS and IIBA courses, and also a mentor to seven apprentices at the moment who are going through the scheme. So quite busy.
And Eirik.
I'm Eirik Netland. I'm a senior business analyst, work in for an employer in the safety science industry, so making sure products are safe for businesses to sell to consumers. I'm also a mentor. So I mentor people on the side of work who approach me for mentoring. So that's also interesting.
Excellent. So it sounds like I couldn't have picked three better people to be talking about BA Insights, and specifically around ethics in relation to business analysis anyway. So brilliant. So let me start with the first big question in terms of your opinions and impressions on what are ethics and what are ethics and what ones apply to business analysis perhaps. So Helen, would you mind if I start with you, please?
I guess when I think about ethics, I think about sort of behaviours and values and the things that are side of right, if you like, of good. So, as you know, my business analysis career has been wholly within the public sector and working in whether it be in policing or in civil service as I am now. So for me, it's about kind of our responsibility, not just obviously in sort of putting forward our own values, but in kind of respecting the values of others and sort of making sure that those are upheld in some of the projects that we're involved in.
Brilliant. Thank you. Yeah, I couldn't put that better myself, that's for sure. So thank you. Imtiaz, would you mind giving your perspective, please?
Yeah, I guess just to add to what Helen said, a couple of things sort of spring to mind. Kind of my moral ethical compass, really, but with a BA lens on. I think, you know, integrity is key. Integrity in how we work, how we communicate, you know, how we listen, as well as, you know, what we talk and what we write, you know, acting with integrity at all times. I think objectivity is quite key with this. You know, we try and not bring our own moral compass to work. I try my best to remove as much cognitive bias that I have with the work I do. But trying to be objective, I think, is really key. And working with our stakeholders and the businesses that we work in. And I guess increasingly more so with a wider ethical lens as BAs, thinking about the impact our projects have, you know, globally, in the communities that we're working in, the environments that we live in, and the world that we live in as well, which is, I think, certainly in my work over the last 5 years, 6 years, definitely become a bigger piece of the jigsaw that I'm trying to put together.
Eirik, over to you, please.
I don't have much to add to what Helen and MTS said. I think it's right that we consider the values, the not just our own moral compass, but also the values that we're operating within on the projects or products we're working on. And I guess one aspect of what might constitute ethics is what laws do we need to abide by in the context of the solution we're working to provide. or the problem that we're aiming to solve. So I guess that's another aspect to this as well, the regulations and laws.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think just building on that, and sorry to come in again, John, but there's that legal aspect, and it just kind of made me also think about, I mean, of course, there is like a professional code of conduct for us as BAs, and I think also it's quite a good way to remember that there's also a set of kind of like professional, when we think of the competencies, the personal and behavioural competencies that are kind of set out, that I think when you look through those encompass a lot of the things that we would consider in this area of ethics. So I think those are the types of things as well that I think as BAs, I think we've got some responsibility to be aware of those and to kind of enact those in our roles.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's an excellent point on the typical BA competencies as well. And particularly if we think about those personal competencies that we tend to bring, I think we would naturally think about, you know, treating people with respect, having integrity, trying to behave with honesty, trying to be transparent as well. And I think by doing those things and quite a few other things as well that under the ethical banner, that will hopefully promote that similar approach from those that we speak to and those that we work with as well. Almost like lead from example in that sense.
Yeah, I think without doubt, our competencies almost allude themselves to good sort of, you know, honesty and integrity and objectivity, you know, good kind of moral compass. And it can be quite a challenge. I think I worked in companies where cultures may not align to some of those values and ways of working, and trying to act and behave in the manner I think I should as a BA in an environment that doesn't promote it and arguably doesn't respect it can be a challenge as well. And we've got to try and decide how we proceed, right?
So I think from my experience, I think trying to take the higher ground, as it were, and try and make sure that irrespective of what's happening around us and how other stakeholders are perhaps behaving towards us, that we can try and maintain the highest level of integrity that we can. And that if we, you know, irrespective of maybe that if we don't get all the information ourselves, but we can at least be totally transparent with what we're able to share, as long as we are allowed to share it, it's not private information, you know, making sure that we're honest and open as well in everything that we do, then hopefully those people that we're able to influence, we can influence them in a positive way anyway. Yeah, that's for sure. And I wonder, I mean, perhaps Imtiaz, I'll go back to you on this next question in terms of how consideration of ethics and values, how that influences your approach to business analysis, if at all.
I guess for me that the people we work with, the stakeholders commonly known, but I guess a lot of different experiences early on in my career, that golden rule of trying to treat people as I want to be treated, and doubled it and said, I'm going to treat people how they want to be treated. So in environments that I'm happy in or not necessarily aligned to, actually making the effort to really get to know people. And just because I may disagree with the culture, how they work, their own personal beliefs potentially as well, or how they want to, you know, operate in the work environment, actually really understanding it, getting down to a really good level of knowledge and trying to build trust from that perspective and treating them as individuals, not just trying to replicate my own behaviours on them.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And I think as we talk to stakeholders and meet them for the first time, rather than us assume that our standards, whether we believe them to be high or otherwise, that we assume they are fit for purpose, just asking the individual, you know, what sort of behaviours would they expect? What values would they like to see from us? You know, hopefully they're all things that we can tick off quite easily, but at least it's, if we ask the question, it can not only start to build some trust, but it makes sure that we're achieving the standards that they would expect of us as well. Yeah. Eirik, if I can perhaps ask you a similar question in terms of how the consideration of ethics might impact your own analysis approach, or has done.
Yeah, I think for me, it's important as a business analyst to raise any ethical concerns I have. And to MTS's point, we might have different opinions on what is the right thing to do, but at least when I have a concern to share that and raise that, I think it's important. And perhaps in some cases to, you know, try and influence and recommend going in the direction that I feel is the most ethical choice. But then when it comes to it, we're not necessarily the decision makers on these things. So at least having made my voice heard is the most important aspect. Even if the decision is something that I wouldn't agree with.
Yeah, and at least I would certainly agree. I think an example that springs to mind, particularly as a consultant, you know, where we do get assigned to different projects, and quite a lot of them over time, you know, and there's a question that's been posed to me before in that sense. What happens if you get assigned to a project and you do the initial analysis and you identify that actually the benefits aren't as great as perceived from that project? You know, do you put your hand up and say, actually, this project isn't really going to deliver the outcomes that you expect, even though it might mean maybe myself and some of my other colleagues might be removed from the project as a result? You know, what's the right approach? And I'm glad to say that guidance and behavior at Capco, at the very least, has reinforced what I'm about to say. But very much our belief is that, you know, if it's the right thing for the client and the project to put your hand up and say this isn't going to achieve the benefits, then that's what we do. And actually what we tend to find as well, and I would expect, is that if you are that BA to put your hand up and suggest that possibly the benefits aren't there, if it's proven to be the case, and if the worst case the project is ceased at that point, who's going to be the first business analyst that's going to be contacted when there's a next project? And there probably will be another project, you know. But there's probably no better way to prove yourself, prove that you're working for the benefit of the client.
It builds trust, doesn't it?
It does. Can it be hard to do as well? Maybe as a junior BA or a BA who's on your first job or first gig in this world, and suddenly you see things that maybe you're unhappy with or don't align, or even to your point, deliver full benefit. And the project's got the sign off, it's got the director's buy-in, it's going, it's happening. You know, do you have the confidence, or do you want to be that person to stand up and argue a different perspective, thinking maybe I don't really want to go against the director or the senior business sponsor? There's some competency skills there as well that we need to talk about as well. But it's sometimes not easy, right, to play that role.
And that's, great. I mean, I was definitely going to say, I think for me, courage is such an important part. And you hear actually of BAs that are talking on platforms like LinkedIn about courage, about, you know, imposter syndrome, and actually how we actually need to break through that to have what are sometimes some really challenging conversations. But there is this real need, I think, for us, for various reasons, to lead by example, whether that's because we are the kind of focal point for stakeholders at times, or if you're, you know, a more senior BA, because you may have people looking to you in a kind of mentoring capacity. But, you know, we're all human, right? It's hard and it's difficult, and sometimes we get these things wrong. So I think, John, what you were saying there about, I think we've got to not be afraid to get it wrong sometimes. That's and right. And just to be prepared to have that accountability and to kind of say, right, I'm gonna put my hand up and say, maybe I made a bad choice, or, you know, something's changed and what I thought was the right thing isn't. But then we've also got to, I think, look at how individually and collectively we can build that courage, and we can build that sense of sort of belief in our convictions when we're saying these things as well. Definitely, I think it's important.
Yeah, I think I would agree. I mean, I think as leaders and managers, business analysts, we need to make sure that those in our team, those that we look after, that they feel that they can raise any concerns, and they feel that it actually will. They'll be supported. And so, to Eirik's point earlier on, you know, they don't have to take responsibility for all of the decisions. They just have to take responsibility to raising their hand and letting people know there's concerns, which may or may not prove to uh, to be acted upon in the way they might have perceived anyway. But at least if people can be encouraged to put their hand up, that's one thing. And if leaders can be encouraged as well to trust those people that put their hand up and actually hold it as a beacon for others to follow. You know, I think there's probably plenty of examples where we work on projects and we see people going, I don't know if above and beyond is right example here, but really performing at a higher standard in terms of the values that they put that they're displaying. Mm. If we can identify that and actually put it on a pedestal, then hopefully those are a little bit behind in terms of the values they portray, they might join us on the pedestal.
And I think for the ethical level, once that culture's embedded, the objective unbiased analysis can begin to happen.
Yeah.
Once you've got the confidence of the team, you're working with peers or working with that similar mindset, you know, that freedom and that ability to, you know, assess information, analyze notes, models we've seen, we've listed, we've worked on, but maintain that sort of objective, unbiased perspective and present back the information, the facts, the figures in a way that enables our business partners to make good decisions, right?
That's right. And I think mentioning up bias there as well, I think that's probably a really perfect example to talk about when we think about ethics and how practically it can apply to the BA role. You know, I would say definitely. I guess thinking about then how perhaps ethics might be applied when using emerging technologies was another question that popped up. So I guess for most of us, me particularly as an example, ChatGPT would be one example of that. AI, robotic process automation. I'm sure there's plenty of others that I've missed. Yep. But any views on how ethics might play a part as we use more and more of those emerging technologies I always speak of? Helen, would you like to go first this time?
I think you put forward the real classic example there, which is, I think, AI, and there's obviously a lot of different kind of moral and ethical into that. And it's like anything, isn't it? When you've got this shiny new thing that can do all these great things, I think it's very easy at times to lose sight of some of the inherent risks around that. And I think that's where, I guess, as BAs, we just need to kind of sometimes take that step back and just take that wider view and just think through how these things are used, again, whether that be individually within our teams or our organisations, and just kind of give that consideration before we kind of jump in, and then equally kind of be prepared to share some of those points with our organization and to speak out if we think that something is, you know, the way that something's being used kind of starts to cross that boundary a little bit, and not be afraid to be the voice of caution. That doesn't necessarily mean that you're always, I know it can be perceived as you're trying to hold people back. So I think, that's why I think we've got a responsibility to sometimes have some knowledge about these things so that we can actually go in and advocate for, the right approach within our organisations in a way that isn't just kind of scaremongering, but is balanced.
So, and I think to Imtiaz's point a moment ago, when you talk about being unbiased, I think in order to truly be unbiased, you've got to understand the topics that you're talking about, at least to a level. Anyway, I'd suggest. Eirik, would you like to give your view on that particular question around ethics and how it might be applied for emerging technologies?
Yeah, I think AI is an area that is obviously a big new technology that is coming to stay. Someone, I think, said that it's even bigger than the internet, like with how how it will evolve. And so I think something to consider ethically with AI is, one thing is who's in control of the data, or so are you giving away
we lost you, Eirik.
Can you hear me again?
All right, sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry
Yeah,
I lost you for a few seconds.
Yeah, no worries. I got muted for some reason. So who's owning the data? Are you giving away data, your own data, without realizing? That's one question. And I think something, if we're involved in AI projects or when we are, then I think an important aspect of AI is, is the individual empowered in this solution? Because if not, it's going to go in a direction where the power goes to only a few big companies or something like that, or if governments are, but the more we can distribute the power that comes with a tool like AI to individuals, I think the better it is. So that's something to have in mind when we're working with AI.
Yeah, that's a fair point, because I think the more we can get different people with different backgrounds, different levels of experience and different roles using the tool, they'll all, I guess, the outcomes that apply, because they'll ask different questions, as important as if we were to ask them questions directly and they're feeding back to us. So absolutely, I would agree with that, for sure. Yeah. Imtiaz, do you have a view on that particular question?
Yeah, it's just to take it maybe with a different lens on a macro level. All these technologies and innovations have impacts. The self-checkout in a supermarket where, I used to be one of 60 people on a till, right? There's now 20 or 30. And two-thirds of that space is in some way, shape, or form, some sort of self-service type operation. AI, robotics, changing the face of depots. I could never have imagined myself picking in a Sainsbury's warehouse in Hertfordshire many moons ago, that an arm could do that job and would do that job to great efficiency and great quality. And I think as part of our role going forward, there'll be a lot of projects that we're on, and I've been on a couple, where it's a massive impact on communities, on people, on economies, on the environment, and I guess using the PESL technique, but many other kind of techniques that are out there. We need to bring our external analysis to the table and bring that impact of projects that we're working on to the business table to make people aware of the impact of these wonderful things that do deliver great business benefit ultimately, but they do and often and very often have impacts on the wider community.
Yeah, excellent point. So thank you for that. Well, I think the next point I would like to move on to is really how which BA techniques that we might be able to use to try and ensure that we have integrity, or we demonstrate that integrity, as it were. So as an example, I tend to favour a lot, trying to get any information I have down from various stakeholders on paper as quick as possible, so I can start to share it. I'm very big on making sure that, we either through Confluence sites or SharePoint sites or internal websites, that we use that as a home to put information about the project, what we're finding, our requirements, our process, etc., so that it's out there for everybody who we've engaged with, or those that we haven't, to have a look at it. And if they disagree with it, or they've got points to share, or different priorities, that they can come back to it. So that might be one example from my side.
Yeah.
So, Eirik, I wonder, I'll start with you first this time, if I may, just as I'm conscious that you've been in the middle of the questioning quite a lot, so I'll let you go first, if that's all right.
Yeah, I think they're contributing to the discovery process in different ways to try and influence outcomes early on, I think is good. So things like user research, to get some data backing up the decisions we're making, whether it's qualitative or whether it's quantitative or a combination, I think is would be good. And I think taking a curious approach, things like the five whys when we're thinking about a problem, or continuing to ask questions to make sure we get get to the root of the problem, but also like think about the ethical concerns. And I think, you know, taking a more curious approach can come across less confrontative or assertive when we're talking about potentially sensitive topics like morals and ethics can be. So those are some suggestions.
And that's a good example, right? There's just some fairly simple things that people can do. You know, we don't have to go and be a super experienced business analyst or go and get an MBA to do this. It's a fairly simple thing, you know, about making sure that we are curious, that we're engaging people, that we're given the opportunity to share their views and their perspective, and that we're transparent with it, as another example. So yeah, I think that's a perfect one. Helen, would you mind giving your insight on this one?
Techniques. Yeah, and I think it's something that Imtiaz probably sort of alluded to earlier and talked around. It's that thing about perspectives, isn't it? It's, I think there are a variety of different techniques out there that can help us kind of uncover those types of perspectives, and different approaches that we can take to try and make sure that that everybody kind of has an opportunity to have their voices heard. So, you know, it's kind of just remembering as BAs to watch out for, it's equity rather than equality. I think it's something that I try and hold in my mind, is that it's not always about giving everybody a level playing field. Sometimes you have to recognize that people need a slightly different set of tools in the situation in order to actually feel comfortable to share their views. And whether that be, you know, you've got to set something up separately with a particular individual or group of people to really make sure that you've taken the time to understand them. I think it's things like that. And there are a whole host, as I say, of techniques out there around stakeholder identification, analysis and requirements elicitation that I think we can draw on to achieve that. Definitely.
And a good, brilliant example there of bringing different techniques and ways of working together, rather than there just this one silver bullet that we can apply.
Okay.
And Imtiaz, sorry, did I ask you that question?
I guess just to add to what the guys have said, for me, a couple of things I've really built into my process the last few years. One around, I guess, BA planning and stakeholder engagement, and making fully part of my plan now to engage with teams like corporate social responsibility, HR, just thinking about impacts on people, is in most projects, you know, teams like PR and marketing, because we know the outside world will talk whether we want them to or not.
Yeah,
you know, building that better practice into our work. Totally agree with your point about transparency. I've got a golden rule, it's 24 hours, and I commit to getting everything out to right people within that time frame. And having it available on some, you know, whatever SharePoint type site we're using, I think it's really, really important to work in a, you know, honest, in with high integrity, to keep it all transparent. I guess two other things for me that have become really important. One, tracing of our work.
Yeah.
Because I like to think I do my job fairly well, and I really want to know what decisions are impacting the work that we've committed to, and isn't just, I'm going to drop that off and hope for the best and ignore potential impacts, which can have massive, you know, ethical, moral impacts as well sometimes. So yeah, traceability for me is one key technique I think we should be really adopting more.
Yeah, and it forces us to make sure that we're reflecting all of those links that we have been part of, and often we're glued to these things, but it makes it a bit more transparent. I'm sure we'll have a topic on traceability. I'm sure we're one close to my heart, but I won't get on the soapbox about that. I guess we have a couple of minutes left on the call. I mean, firstly, thank you to everyone else. Thank you to everybody again for your insights. Certainly I found it interesting and valuable to listen to them, and reassuring as well, importantly. As I'm sure and hope those in the wider BA community that see this will also get some value from. Any other points that any of you might wish to raise on the topic of ethics before we draw to a close?
I mean, I would just add that I think, so certainly for me personally, I think in the earlier parts of my BA career, I very much focused on a need to kind of nail the techniques. I wanted to work on that knowledge. I think what I've realized in the last few years is that actually what's just as important is taking the time to work on those elements that are probably that might sometimes seem like they're less to do with your professional role and more to do with you as an individual, but they nevertheless I think have quite a big impact on the impact that you make. I heard a phrase a while back that said who you are is how you lead. And I think that that's therefore really important. And I think certainly it's my kind of commitment at the moment is how can I work on my character, my sense of ethics, my values to make sure that I then bring that into my work as a BA. So I think that's something I'd like to see us all sort of be encouraged to do more of, as well as that kind of, you know, techniques and all those kind of things.
Yeah, absolutely. I think last bit of advice I've made on this front, I think a good thing to do for anybody trying to improve their ethical approach is actually have a look at what others in the community are doing, how they're behaving, how they're acting. I mean, certainly I've observed many people from the BA community over the last year, and I continue to do so. And every time I do, there's something I can learn from every interaction. And I certainly, yeah. This is one such interaction. So thank you for that.
Yeah.
Interest of time. Thank you very much for joining everybody. Draw today's session to a close. Hopefully everybody found that interesting. So thank you very much.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Really good. Thank you.